Now we'll deal with the constituents of torts. As said, that tort was basically for, creating well-being in the society. So now it says that an instrument for making people adhere to standards of reasonable behavior and respect the rights and interests of one another. So the main thing the tort focuses on protecting the interest and maintaining the reasonable standards of behavior. So this is what exactly is the aim of torts, if to maintain the reasonable behavior among the society. So a protected interest gives rise to a legal right, which in turn give rise to a corresponding legal duty. Now this is coming from a jurist called as Hoffields, and he has raised his principle called as Hoffields principle, which says that when there you have a legal right, you are supposed to have corresponding legal duty, which means if you are a person who is holding a right, there's going to be a person who is going to perform for you some duties, and if that person doesn't perform, then he's in breach of duty. So yes, if you are a right holder, there is going to be one person who is going to perform for you, who is going to be a duty holder. So this is what it says: a protected interest gives rise to legal rights, which in turn gives rise to a corresponding legal duty. Then, as we said, Hoffield's principle. Then we have an act which infringes a legal right is a wrongful act. So this, again, it comes to the same principle where you are a duty holder and you are supposed to perform the rights as which was specified in your specified by your right holder person. But this has not been performed, or if those duties or obligations are not performed, then you are in breach of certain obligations and you have committed a wrongful act. To constitute, now we come to the final phase where we say what will constitute a tort. So to constitute a tort, we require the three elements, or for the civil injury, the first element is wrongful act. So there has to be a wrongful act done by the party, and hence you can claim for tort. Then there is legal damages. So if there is only wrongful act, but the third party or the person who has approached the court has not suffered any legal damage, then he will not be entitled in the courts of law to claim for damages or under a law of tort, he will not be entitled to say that there was a wrongful act. And the final thing is there has to be legal remedy. So if there is a legal remedy available, then only you can approach the courts. And for before legal remedy, there has to be shown that there was a legal damages, and hence to claim legal damages, the person has approached the courts because of the third party doing a wrongful act. So now we see, to constitute a tort or civil injury, there must be wrongful act committed by a person. So the first requirement, which is written on the board also, wrongful act committed by a person. Wrongful act must give rise to legal damages or actual damages. So second point is there has to be damages. And the third is the wrongful act must be of such a nature to give rise to legal remedy in the form of action for damages. So there has to be remedy with regards to action for damages. So this can be in amount of compensation or injunction order, something to that effect, and hence you can approach the court for a wrongful act done by the other person. Now we see what is a wrongful act. Wrongful act is something legally wrongful and which the party is complaining it not in accordance with the instructions or as per your societal norms. So that is your wrongful act. So we take an example here, as if you have a plot of land, and then you have a neighboring person who is staying besides you, and you have constructed a wall, a high-rise wall. Now it happens to be that the neighboring person is not able to receive sunlight because of the wall you have constructed. In that scenario, the neighbors or the neighboring person have been affected by the wall, by the construction of the wall, and hence it will be said that you have committed a tort because you are causing them damages, you are not allowing them to receive the sunlight. So this is something if the wall was constructed with permission, yes, then it will not have problems. But if it is unlawfully constructed, then again it will have lot of consequences around it, and it will be considered as a tort because you have not taken into consideration the other party's objections or understandings, and you have still built up the wall and you have not allowed them to access or take the advantage of the light, the natural light. Then we see rights available against the world are numerous. So this is again a tort where we say that where we did the unity theory, where there are lot many rights and there are lot many torts. Everything is a tort until and unless it comes under some justification or exception. So rights available against the world at large are very numerous. Now they are subdivided into private rights and public rights. Now private rights deal with individuals. So we say private rights, all rights which belong to a particular person to the exclusion of the world at large. So only one person, only that individual will have a right. Now this will be right to reputation, your rights to bodily safety. All of these rights get covered under your private right. While public right is opposite, and it is available to world at large. So that will be that you are avoiding noise pollution. So the whole society wants that right. So hence it is available to the world at large. So then you have right to fresh air, which is actually most of these rights are covered under your Article 21 of the Constitution of India. So these are your public rights. Then public rights also includes that which belong to common to the members of the state. So it is not only restricted to your community or your locality, but it is something which is extended to the state at large. So hence we say Article 21 of the Constitution of India, where there are many rights which have been extended to the citizens of India, and it has been considered that it is a necessity, it is a right, and without which there is no healthy living being. So it is not a healthy lifestyle. So yes, these are the rights which have been extended under your Article 21. Then to every right, there is a corresponding duty or obligation. If the right is legal, so is the obligation. And if the right is contingent, imaginary or moral, so is the obligation. So this again, we come back to Hoffield's principle, where you have a corresponding duty attached to a right. And if it is a legal right, obviously you will have a legal duty. And if it is a moral right, you will have a moral duty. So it goes together. Whatever is the right, whatever is the nature of your right, it will have the nature of your duty. Now the duty with which the law of tort is concerned is duty to abstain from willful injury, to respect the property of others, and to use due diligence to avoid cause harm to others. So the first thing they say is abstain from willful injury. This is the law of torts protects a person from the personal injury or his property, any injury caused to his property. So he has a right to defend, or he has a right to claim compensation if there is any loss, injury suffered to that individual or to the property of that individual. So this is what is the duty. The duty will be to the world at large, all the people who are coming near the property or to the or coming near to that individual. He will have the right to defend and to protect his life and property. Then we say liability for tort arises when wrongful act complaint of amounts either to an infringement of a legal private right or a breach or violation of legal duty. So now again you have infringement of legal private right. Private right is again you are dealing with yourself, your right to reputation. If there is defamation, then again it's a private right. So that is infringement of legal private right. Any wrongful act done towards infringing a person's private right will be considered as tort. or a breach or violation of legal duty. As we said, right is always corresponding to duty, and hence there is a person, if he breaches the duty, he has committed a tort, and there is going to be a corresponding right and duty attached. Now the third thing, we'll go to the second, which is legal damages. Second constituents of tort, that is legal damages, there has to be some amount or there has to be a legal damage to show that it is coming under a tort, that wrongful act is coming under a tort. So the damages means harm or loss suffered or presumed to be suffered by a person as a result of some wrongful act of another. The sum of money awarded by courts to compensate damages is called damages. So here the thing which is being taken into consideration is loss, harm or loss suffered. So this is the first thing where a person suffers a harm or loss due to the wrongful act of another person. So there is another person who has caused, who is in breach of duty or is just negligent enough and has caused or committed a wrongful act, and there is a harm or loss suffered to the first party, then he has the right to claim for compensation for that amount or for unliquidated damages, and this, the whatever the amount which the court orders is considered as damages. Now, there are certain presumptions for damages. So, the rights are classified into two types, that is absolute and qualified rights. So, this is for damages when you have an absolute right and when you have a qualified right. When an absolute right is violated, the law conclusively presumes damages, although the person wronged may have suffered no pecuniary loss whatsoever. So now, here the consideration is for absolute right. Now the law is not going to see whether the law, whether the damages or wrongful act is committed or not committed. It is presumed that the wrongful act has been committed and it is a tort. So this is what is your actual absolute right is looking into it. And the damages which is presumed is also called as legal damages. Now for this, the onus of proving that the damages was not done will lie on the plaintiff, because the plaintiff is the person who is approaching the court, and the courts are going to presume that the damages was done and there is a tort which has been committed. Now when we take the qualified rights, in case of qualified rights, there is no presumption of legal damage, and violation of such rights is actionable only on proof of actual and special damages. Now for qualified rights, you will require a proof of actual damage or a special damage, then only you can approach the courts and you can say there was a tort committed. But if it is your absolute right and if it is an absolute damages, then you are not supposed to prove that there was damages. It is presumed that you there was a tort committed and there was a wrongful act done, which will amount to damages or compensation. Then we have two theories, which is damnum sine injuria and injuria sine damnum. Damnum means damages, injuria means injury. So first one is damnum sine injuria, which means damages without injury. So there is going to be damages, there is going to be damages of your legal rights, but there is no injury caused to another person. How is this happening or how is this going to stay? We have a case law for that, that is called Ashby versus White. Now in this case, there was a voting which was taken place, there was a voting booth. The officer in charge denied a person to vote, and even though he intended to vote for one person and that person only won the elections, but he still approached the court saying that his right was denied of voting. So the court said yes, there was damages to his legal rights, though there was no injury because the party or the person he was intending to vote has won the case or has won the election, and hence there was no injury to him, but there was damages to his right. So there was damages to his legal right, and hence he is entitled to claim compensation even though he did not suffer any injury. Then we come to the next maxim, that is injuria sine damnum. So in injuria sine damnum, there is infringement of absolute private or legal right without any actual loss or damages. Now the person whose right is infringed has cause of action. The person whose right has been infringed will have a right to approach the courts. So now for this we have a case law, which is Gloucester Grammar School case. Now in this there was a defendant who is the schoolmaster who had set up a school just adjoining the school, which was doing very well, which was flourishing, and he's just set up a school besides that school. So what happens to be is most of the students from one school, from the A school, which was already established, transfers and takes an admission in B school. So now the principal or the directors of the A school files a complaint and or a law, files a tort for a wrongful act of the B school, so the headmaster or the director of the B school, saying that there is a loss of business, there is loss of profits, because most of the students from A schools are getting admissions in B schools and taking a transfer. So the court said that even though there is a monetary loss or there is injury, but there is no legal damages. You do not have any legal right to approach the court. But there is no damages or towards your legal rights. You are suffering an injury, that is, you are suffering a monetary loss, but you do not have a right to stand in court because you are suffering, because there is no legal right available to you. So one more case we have for this, that is called as Mughal Steamship Company versus McGregor Grove. Now in this case, there were some tradesmen who were actually transporting or who were shipping tea from one port to another port. Now there was 4 to 5 persons who were like the ship owners who were in this business. So A to D, we'll consider that there were 4, A, B, C, D were the 4 business dealers, and they clubbed or they formed a union, not even union which was registered. They just amongst each other discussed and said that we will not ship, or we will take the teas and not give that opportunity to F, who is the other person who is also a ship owner. We'll not give him an opportunity to transport tea from one port to another port. And these 4 formed a union and they started distributing amongst themselves. So again, the courts considered and said that F was denied business, but that will not be considered that it was his legal right. It was something in competition. It was in a competition spirit. So A to D were allowed to form a coalition and go ahead with the transportation or shipping business of transporting tea from one place to another, and which was not the same for F, and F had to deal it all alone. So it was only loss of profits and business for him and not any damages or injury. So now we see what is the actual difference. Like damnum sine injuria is actual and substantial loss without infringement of any legal right, then you cannot have any action. So there has to be, for damnum sine injuria, the first thing, there has to be an actual and substantial loss without infringement of your legal right. You are getting it, but there is no infringement of legal right. Then, so mere loss of money or money's worth does not itself constitute a tort. So for it, you are supposed to show that there was an actual loss and substantial loss, but there was no legal right, infringement of legal right available. So now we'll see the difference between damnum sine injuria and injuria sine damnum. So damnum sine injuria means actual and substantial loss without infringement of any legal right, no action will lie. So now in this, there has to be actual and substantial loss without infringement of legal right. So if there is damage, which is damage to your legal right, but there is no injury suffered, then there will be no action which will lie. But and you are supposed to show that there is damages because you are getting covered under your second point, which is legal damages. You are supposed to be entitled to get those damages. We have a case which is like a bank, which is called as Marzetti versus Williams. In this case, an action will lie against a banker having sufficient fund in his hands belonging to a customer for refusing to honor his check. Now, in this case where we say that the person had enough amount and the banker also had enough amount, but he still refused to honor his check. Now, the customer will not sustain any actual loss or damages because there's not going to be any loss of transfer of amount, but it is his right, which is legal. So there is injury or damages to his legal right, which he could have claimed, but there is no actual loss or damages. So this is where we say it is damnum sine injuria. There is substantial loss. This we will say is injuria sine damnum, where there is substantial loss, but there is no damages which is suffered. While in damnum sine injuria, there has to be substantial loss where damages is suffered, but you still don't have a legal right, which are the school, which is the case of your school case and then your ship owner's case. So this is what is the two principle, damnum sine injuria and injuria sine damnum. So now we will see the final element of tort, that is legal remedies. You should have a legal remedy to approach the court if there is a wrongful act done. So what is a legal remedy or what will be a tort? A tort is civil injury, but all civil injuries are not tort. So the first thing for tort is it has to be a civil injury, but they are saying all civil injuries, which is all private rights or all all private rights will not be a tort. Why they are saying is because there are some rights which get covered under your contract, which though are private rights, but they are covered under contract and hence it will not be considered as torts. Now, what is the remedy? The essential remedy for a tort is an action for damages, but there are other remedies, that is injunction, or you can ask the courts to stay. So there is stay order which can be taken into picture, or there is an injunction. Injunction is where you prevent a person from doing an act or you from doing an act of that person which is a wrongful act. So that is the order which can be taken into consideration. And the final thing or the main thing on which the tort prevails is claim for damages. Damages is something called as compensation as well. So you can ask for compensation. Now this, or you can say the development of tort has happened because of the principle or maxim called as ubi jus ibi remedium, which means where there is a right, there is a legal remedy. So there has to be a right and there has to be a remedy. So if there is any person who has breached a legal duty, it gives the right to another person who was the right holder, and then he can approach the court because he has legal remedy. So we say the law of tort is based on the maxim ubi jus ibi remedium. Jus, which is jus in the ubi jus ibi remedium, the second word means the legal authority to do or to demand something. So now this legal authority has a right, or you know, the person will have a right to demand something, and remedium may be right of action, which is the last word where it gives right to the right of action. So this and the ubi jus ibi remedium says if a man has a right, he must of necessity have a means to vindicate and maintain it, and a remedy if he is injured in the exercise or enjoyment of it, and indeed it is a vein in reciprocal. So what happens is if a person who is holding a right and if there is a breach of right, then the other party or that first person himself should have a right to approach the court because there is the third person or the second person who has breached to perform his obligations or duty. Hence, if the person who has a right is not allowed to approach the court, then he will have no remedy. And if you do not have a right, or if you do not have a remedy, then there is no use to have a right. Hence, we say the law of tort is based on the principle ubi jus ibi remedium, where there is a person who has a right, he also has a legal remedy, and the legal remedy is to claim for damages, to claim for compensation, for injunction, and approach the courts as well. So for torts, we require all the three elements. First is a wrongful act. There has to be a wrongful act committed by the first person. Second is there has to be damages. If there is a wrongful act but no damages, then it is not a tort. But if it is a wrongful act with damages, it will be a tort. And because it is with damages, the third thing which is required is remedy. Remedy means approaching the courts, claiming for compensation, or asking a person to stay, asking a person for a stay or an injunction order.